Welcome back, everybody, here to our final game of the night. Power Rangers versus Danish Bears, our third and deciding matchup in this lower bracket final for the Epicenter qualifier for the European region. $500,000. The top teams in Moscow competing in May. You have it all written up the top and right-hand side corner of your screen, but I still want to say it anyway. A great event coming up, and they definitely want to qualify. They'll get you into the grand final. They can win it up against No Diggity. And a man who doesn't even need to qualify for anything anymore because he should be invited to absolutely everything is my co-caster. It is Complexity's Captain Swindle Melons. Welcome back, man.
Hey, glad we have a game 3. I always love game 3s. And I don't know about those invites, man. I got my fingers crossed, but we had to win our qualifier the old-fashioned way, too, for this event. And we were very, very... You were there for that. We were on the verge of not making it, but let's not talk about that. Night Stalker first pick. So this was actually banned in addition to the Alchemist in the game.
But... Can't we talk about it? That best of five was amazing, man. I thought I was going to be home at 3 a.m. in the morning. I went home at 6 a.m. in the morning. Because you couldn't win a game.
We tried our best, man. Sometimes you just lose.
You went tilt.
We were not tilted.
You were. There was something wrong. I actually realized I hadn't given you any level of shit for that. And I really, really wanted to.
A win is a win, Toby.
A win is a win when you barely make it in the fifth game. Oh, I felt so angry that night. Oh, well, a first 2 gyrocopter and a Night Stalker as well. First time Night Stalker's not banned, Ace goes instantly for it and combos it with his gyrocopter. But Power Rangers go with the same draft they started with previously. The Chen and Invoker pickup.
I like it. I think the Night Stalker gyro makes a lot of sense too. Apparently DB fucking loves their Night Stalker, and the gyro, as we talked about before, is just a very good matchup against the style PR is going to try and run with this draft. Aggroing into a Void IO? Yeah, that'll work. Aggroing into Gyro IO? Not nearly the same strength, so we'll see.
Yeah, and we will. I always feel a little odd with the Night Stalker pickup. I know you've been saying like Beastmaster as well as Night Stalker are absolutely amazing in combination. I mean, not in combination, just for their vision, what they give. And I just feel like Night Stalker always is that weaker laner in the first 4 minutes where like everyone else can just rotate, like the Earth Spirit can go walk all over you and the Night Stalker can't do anything. I know that you get like that power spike up at 4 minutes in any way, but It's just that weird thing in my head. I shouldn't even bring it up. Ignore it. Ignore that comment. It's stupid. Night Stalker is wonderfully powerful, everyone. You should draft him in every single game if you know how to play him. Get Night and Talon. You're good.
It's another hero where it's hard for the layman to understand why the hero's power is so high, because it's not so much even the hero's abilities. It's about the map control and then your team's effective use of it. Information is a form of resource in Dota, so you might necessarily not have more gold, but the advantage of the high ground or initiation in a team fight can often be worth, you know, like an item slot. So that's really why Night Stalker is so effective, and DB seemed to play much better around having more information and map control, as they did in the first game, than they did in game 2. So I think it fits their style, and everyone's been banning it against them, so maybe they will show me something, like how you can use it.
I kind of want to see what they were going to use the Keeper of the Light for, if that was even going to be a pickup by DB. Sorry. What I hear coming from the background in your house is so hilarious. It actually came out at one point during one of those fights at the very end of it, where it was almost just like an Arnie scream of no. It was... Yeah, sorry.
Oh, Jesus. No, it's in Swedish. What are we going to do, Toby?
Silence the Swedes. That's the Arnie one. That's the Arnie one.
No comment, man. No comment.
This draft looks really, really familiar, doesn't it? Not Danish Bears, just Power Rangers.
I'm actually just so against what they're doing here. I like having the same opener. I guess the Lions okay, too, but... I used to do this sort of thing where you'd win a game and you run something really similar, but one, it's kind of boring, and two, it just doesn't really give respect to your opponents.
Well, there you go. They mix it up now. Faceless Void pickup. So they get their. We're going to get a real offlane Void in this game. Like, yeah, that safe lane Void. That's the second safe lane Void I've seen in the last week. I'm referring to the last game. And it just. It felt so underwhelming. But that safe lane Void also went for a Helm of the Dominator as well as a Vladimir's Offering. Had both items on the same Void in the same game. 5 seconds remaining. It's... Yeah. 20 minutes in, would you believe the Void did no damage?
Yeah, right?
Oh, I never want to see that again, actually. For Danish Bears, they get a win to Wyvern. So as far as teamfight goes, they're looking a lot better than they were in the last game. A lot of control abilities, even if it's not like a raw stun. And a Bounty Hunter as well, so we're running a core Nightstalker offlane with a roaming bounty and a Wyvern Gyro safe.
Yep, I like it a lot actually. Your Gyro is going to be pretty self-sufficient in the bottom lane. The Void will get a ton of XP because they can really only harass him. They can't ever kill him in the bottom lane. But Nightstalker is one of those heroes. Like, compare the power level on the Nightstalker versus Lion. Nightstalker is way ahead. And with the bounty able to support him, they should pretty much win a 2v2. Invoker will be last picked up against, and I see a TA coming. I think that's like almost a given. I think for DB here,
you see a TA. You're not thinking like an OD would still be a way to go.
I don't like OD at all here. I think they need something that can fight early and often, and none of these heroes at PR are gonna have high armor ever. I think TA, you can get ahead, take an ancient stack. Once you get that blink deso, you'll have the vision advantage through Night Stalker and your traps. I think that's how you beat PR. I don't think that DB is gonna beat them by team fighting here. They need to just contest the lanes hard, force the Chen to be concerned about the top lane, and they need a mid hero that beats Invoker in one-on-one. In my opinion, TA is the best bet there, especially with Puck banned. Bottom lane, as I said, they won't be able to kill Void, but they will win the lane. I think Wyvern should spend more time pulling, maybe gank mid once, but sort of the same as last game. Both supports of DB won't really have a lane they're necessary in. It's all going to be about how do they make rotations around the map, do they pull, how do they get more out of the map than this Chen. And a lot of that's going to be on Bounty Hunter, because he can go anywhere right now and be really effective.
Yeah. So how are you going to wrap this one up, Power Rangers? Like, who's your safe laner? Assuming this will still just be the Faces Void offlane, which is a pretty easy assumption. Someone that can get involved in the fights. You mentioned there is a lot of armor missing from Power Rangers. So maybe you need someone that's a little bit more survivable. They actually go for the OD themselves. So we're running a safe lane OD, an Invoker mid, a Void off lane, and then the Chen Lion on top of that. Yeah.
It is really good. Nightstalker is just such an amazing pick in this game already, I think. Like, I know they first picked it, but excellent against OD and Void. They fight only through auto attacks, so you put 7 seconds of mischance on him, silence him as well. Like, what does OD actually do, you know? He can't orb, he'll miss everything, the hero's just crippled. I really don't like that pick. I think that's just a denial to DB, but if he doesn't really dominate the laning stage, I'm favoring DB's lineup a little bit here. I think Wyvern ulti, oof, I don't know about that. That's
it's a penguin hero. It's a penguin hero.
Yep.
That's the reason for it. He just feels really comfortable on this hero, and he has dominated many lineups with it, so I am not even going to judge him for it. I can see where you were coming from with a TA, but the Wind Ranger also gives them something they needed drastically, the ability to actually siege into high ground. They don't really have that for the rest of the lineup.
Sort of the same issue as the last game. Where's their damage coming from here? It's Windranger and Gyro. Both those heroes need a lot of time to come online. And while their laning stage might once again go well, what are they going to do if they just start getting pushed on? Like, later on in the game, sure, OD will be really crippled. He won't be able to attack many things, but...
They rely on the Bounty Hunter keeping the Chen down with no levels. Yeah. And the Splinter Blast stopping out like a big creep wave push. That's actually got to be it. And maybe we also have to put a little bit more pressure on the Nightstalker during the nighttime phase, where Hester Joe has to go out there and find kills.
Prepare for battle. Problem is, Wind Ranger against OD in theory is really nice, but OD just imprisons you on your wind run, and if there's a Chen in the area, a Lion in the area, Wind Ranger just dies. And even Wyvern isn't exactly the best defensive support against OD, since the pure damage and the insteal will still go through the Cold Embrace. In addition, traditionally with carries, if it's like a Klinx or a Sven or something, and you Wyvern ult a hero close by, then that hero just kind of dies to your core, whereas OD's orb won't affect allies. So the Wyvern ulti won't actually be able to turn around and kill something unless it catches the Invoker and the Forge Spirits too. So a lot of this is going to come down to the tower defense. Like this, I say this all the time, but this tower, vitally important. If Radiant lose this tower before 10, 12 minutes, and they don't either get a trade, they lose a couple heroes, their win percentage goes down to like 20% or less. Like, they're in a really tough spot if that happens. So they need a great early game. They need this Nightstalker and Bounty to have crazy good rotations, and we'll just see. The Chen is really the key hero here for PR. If he makes things happen, it's a tough game for DB for sure.
Cheshire Cat is getting the hell out of here. He's going to get attacked by Roshan. Luckily for him, he doesn't get bashed, but the rune's going to be a trade-off. This is this play that PR went for with the Obs and the Sentry Ward down here. I've seen them do this 3 times out of the 3 games I remember they played against a bounty hunter. It's every single time they're actually on dire side for it too. And this is like my memory over the last 2 weeks. They seem to be really generic with their initial rollouts before the Foghorn.
Yep. And it's something you get away with at this level, but like it's actually really effective to do what they did. But teams will just sort of see that coming. So we used to do that all the time in Complexity, and then people would just start countering both wards and you're like, shit. In this instance, obviously, the Bounty Hunter is not prepared, and he will not only get his ward countered, but they know exactly what he's doing.
Yep. He might be actually working it out.
They put Invoker mid. I didn't mention that, but Invoker went mid.
Yep.
Which isn't bad, but he loses to Windranger, and top lane, they'll shut down the Nightstalker a little better, but this just means the Chen will focus more on farming and not so much helping lanes, because they're relatively secure.
Noir has now got invis like 3 times on top of that Observer Ward. He runs to the mid, and Arise knows where he is. Unfortunately, he's just out of range of the sentry, and now he walks in range of another sentry. So he's probably going to commit his own sentry to dewarding the other sentry that's here in the lane. Bum 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 bum.
Oh, Arise which doesn't get it. That's unfortunate.
He can still walk up and tango the Observer Ward. He's been waiting for that for a while now. So he's probably still okay with this.
Yeah, I'll take it. This is not what you want your Bounty Hunter to be doing, though, at all. It's really... You want it to be having more of an impact. Again, I always use EG as an example. Fear would have done something in this game at this point. He will control the top rune, but... This is not what you want out of Bounty Hunter. He's not shutting down the Chen either, who also got a nice Satyr spawn, so... We'll see what happens. Bottom lane, though, is pretty good for PR in the sense that it's just a 1v1, and Void does A-OK against Gyrocopter.
Yeah. I don't think PR would be too sad about this at all. He's still got this Obs and Sentry. Big Dom's got so much information right now. Like, Noir goes Invis again. He's going to actually miss the Satyr Blast. But Noir's got to work out that he is, like, something is wrong. The PR have too much information for their own good.
Top lane's going very well for the OD, as expected. What does the Nightstalker do, 1 against 2, when it's these heroes?
Well, I would say not a lot, but he also got into the side camps and actually managed to farm up a little bit of that. So he has
an Iron Talent coming as well.
He managed to hit level 3.5, like 3 minutes in. That's not too bad. For a 4 CS hero, I think you're going to be okay with that.
Yeah. I'm actually surprised he got that much, even. And now that he has Iron Talon, he just kind of turns into a subpar jungle hero. But not even that subpar, to be honest. You can pretty much keep up with the Chen at this point, especially once it hits nighttime. Main thing is this Bounty Hunter. He's got to get active in the game. Wyvern also not really pulling too much. He's approaching level 3, which isn't bad. But if you look at CS, I think PR's got a definite advantage here.
Yeah. almost every single one of their cores is ahead. The only one who's just a little bit behind is the Faceless Void, but it's a Void offlane at 9-4. Everyone else is ahead of them all. And it's also great the fact that Chen doesn't have to be on this top lane all the time. Even J4, like with his pulling, he's allowed Goddamn to get a lot of space to get levels on this safe laner. Because the presence isn't really applied by the Bounty Hunter. You're talking about like how Bounty and Nightstalker can synergize together on that top lane. But Noi has been spending almost like this time exclusively against Arise, trying to keep the Invoker down. Meaning the Nightstalkers have no real way that he could fight. Like he gets his Iron Talon now, starts up his farm, waits for the dire creep wave to push back down again, but J4 just double stacked. So the next creep wave is going to get denied. He will not get the experience he's looking for. So now he just turns this into a jungling Nightstalker for the next 45 seconds. Until nighttime appears, obviously.
I don't really agree with how the Bounty's played this. I think he could have done a lot more work, even bottom, perhaps, to potentially kill that Void, or to help the Nightstalker top, but this is... It's just a kind of a poor position for him, because his only place to do anything now is mid, and like, what do you really do against an Invoker with a Windmaker?
He's got time walk up, go into the trees and trigger off the salve, put Ace and Ryzen very, very far in the Sunstrike!
Wow.
Oh, you said he was normally a second behind, Ryzen had all the time in the world to think about that Sunstrike. So first blood goes to the mid Invoker, sniping out the support in the bottom lane.
Really important there. Windranger should be able to go get that DD bottom, which will be nice for him, but it's again my problem with this hero right now in the meta. Like, he doesn't really do anything for quite some time. And lane dominance, as we saw yesterday, I think you were casting. We watched Dendi play Windranger against a Puck and just body him in lane. But if you can't do that, the hero is really not nearly as strong. Which is why I probably would have preferred a TA, just because it doesn't matter if you don't crush the lane, you just go do Ancients and then you are. But Windranger really needs to make things happen through mid, and as we've seen, it's kind of ineffective with just a Bounty Hunter here. They will rotate the Nightstalker, who will solo smoke. Nighttime as well, obviously.
Doesn't Arise just look so much more comfortable in this game as well?
Yes, definitely, I agree.
Like, even at this point, because like, he can still have that level of aggression. By having his four spirits on the front line without having to risk his hero all the time. And every time Bounty Hunter's come to actually gank him, he's never really walked down the stair line. Arise just stays alive and gets rewarded for his efforts.
Look at the bottom lane. They're going to flak it out. It's a really good rotation from Nightstalker. They will not see this coming, and this should be a very easy kill if he gets the silence off. He has a DD as well, so...
Well, there's your Void, there's your Silence. Cooldown's on its way in. Have they got enough damage to kill Cheshire Cat in time? The answer? Nice. Only barely. Like, that Silence came off just at the last second where he potentially could have time-walked.
That was a really big kill. They'll be able to pressure the tower a bit. And that was a needed kill. Apologies for the background noise.
It's okay. They're actually quieter than they were before. Now a smoke time for PR. So they bring a level 4.5 Chen, as well as a level 3 Lion into the mid lane. The Observer's still down, so they still understand the Penguin's here, and they start off with the Hex, the Sunstrike, and the Penitence, increasing that damage. Arise still a very long way over, and Heads of Joe rotates in as well, but they've got a lot of auras. They've still got that Satter Blast to Duke it available as well. The Splinter Blast just pushes PR a little bit back, however. But you're fine with that. You just killed off your mid laner, you force heavy rotations out from DB, you're wasting more of the night time, and Arise practically completed up his Midas.
Yep.
Being involved in that kill.
You look at the net worths, it kind of shows the way this game is going. You know PR supports are going to get more. If like DB are the ones who have to do things. Like they have a Gyro and a Windranger for damage. And as we said, like it's the same thing that happens in a lot of these dual core lineups. If you kill one of them or one of them has a bad game, suddenly you just need to control one hero and all the damage output just disappears. And that's the situation DB are headed for if they don't start making things happen. Like the Chen hasn't even got involved yet.
Void.
He's level 5.
Chrono on bottom lane. You wanted one of them controlled. Lion's going to take the last hit. You're perfectly alright with that, primarily because J4 is going to get closer and closer towards that Blink Dagger. So then PR actually have jump and initiation that doesn't require one smoke and two Faces Void to expose himself.
Yep. And that's, again, the strength of this PR lineup. They have such a good one.
They're going
top
lane. Goddamn straight up TP's out. The sun was already used, so he was free to leave.
Yeah, and this is the strength of PR's lineup. Lion plus one is going to be a kill. Void ulti plus one is going to be a kill, mostly due to that Sunstrike and just the way their lineup is scored. So Void in this game makes a lot more sense because every time he ults, it'll normally be on a hero that's alone. There's no real counterplay other than a Wyvern E, and they can just kill Gyro very easily with that Sunstrike. And Arai's already off to a great start. He's got a Midas at 7 minutes. Like, that's so strong.
Yep.
Level 8 on E as well.
Yeah, this is going to be a very quick and a high level up Sunstrike. This was actually makes Cheshire Cat's combo even better. Like, you always think about having, like, this raw damage output from someone like a Witch Doctor or a Sky Wraith Mage combining it with the Faceless Void, and that's just, like, TI's impact on my brain. But when you see something like a really quick leveling up Invoker, that stuff right there, a Sunstrike in the middle of a Faceless Void Chronosphere does so much work, and it looks like they actually just called out Nightstalker as well in the top river. So he's down as well. Another kill coming the way of Arai. He's now got two. He's been involved in all four kills of PR so far.
Yep. Just solid play, man. And they're going to just push top now. Now the Chen's involved. He's got Arcanes, about a third of his mech, level 6. This is where they get really scary, because in the meantime, Void will have his ult soon, and he'll just stay bottom and threaten this Gyrocopter at all times. He's actually going to rotate top on Jar right away. They're gonna fight here, but there's already a really nice ward placed by PR, so they'll probably just back here and still, like, two cores still farming easily in their lanes.
Yep. Why even come into the fight unless you feel overconfident? Like, if you had Finger of Death, I can understand PR hanging around, leave the Sentry Ward down, wait for the bounty to come up, and then just pop him. But they're actually gonna smoke themselves, so they're ready to find up on top. They had the Observer Ward there. Remember, they still don't have that level 6 over a Lion, but they're coming mid. They're coming after Penguin. He's still got Windrunner Varble. J4 won't reach him in time. He Windruns back into the safety of the trees.
It's all good, though. Like, the main other issue with DB's lineup, who's going to pressure these towers? Their only choice, really, is to follow the Chen around the map and try and defend, which is what Wyvern's about to do here. The problem is that, in the meantime, Void's split pushing bottom easily, and they can't kill him, whereas the Gyro pushing top is not only slow, but very exposed if they wanted to try and go for a kill on him. So that's another big advantage of PR. They're going to win a lot of these skirmishes, and they have more of an ability to pressure towers.
What are you up to, goddamn?
I don't know. Aquila on the OD, by the way. I haven't seen that before. I've seen it on Invoker, but not OD.
I wonder why.
Man, it's not bad. It gives you some much-needed armor, and just the attack speed's nice, but it is a little strange.
Unless they're starting to, like, get every single possible aura they can stack up into. Because no one else is going to build an Aquila in this game. Hey, J4 actually... Okay, he got his Triangle Boots, but he also just got his level 6, so... Cheshire Cat's actually getting a casual headdress into Vlad, so normal build we get to see from Faceless Voids. Yeah, they're going to stack up all of their auras when they're ready to 5-man it out, and DB's not really going to be prepared for it.
If you look at the net worth in XP, it's 3k in both categories, advantage for PR. The stagnant game will favor them. The Invoker's very far.
Already imprisonment.
Still getting what he can.
Sunstrike on the top lane, combining out with the Sun's a good curse on top of J4. Ace, well, that orb attack. Okay, Finger of Death just being committed. Goddamn, still stolen 15 intelligence with a couple more attacks. He can throw the ulti down, and that'll probably kill off. Well, he doesn't need to do it anymore. Hester Joe is 100% dead. Void goes in deeper. Three heroes now from DB defending this top lane. Cheshire Cat will time walk off a lot of the damage which was dealt to him. And goddamn, you can see what he wants. He wants to force DB into a fight by imprisoning up one. He's going to kill off Noya with that ulti throwdown. And they still have a nice little Penguin. Four heroes down. A great read from PR, turning what looked only to be like one kill and a fallback from DB into four full kills in their favor.
Yep, this excellent job. They went on the Gyro. He doesn't get call down, a Q, anything off. And even though they were a little out of position, without the Gyrocopter, where's the damage for DB coming from, you know? The Wyvern ulti wasn't bad, but, like, they just don't have any damage without Gyrocopter there.
Even with the Gyrocopter, that damage may not mean anything anymore. Like, Big Num's now 300 gold away from his mech. Once that's up, the cooldown damage is negated. If he's got Hand of God as well, then even Splinter Blast is then negated as well.
Yep. It's just good Dota, man. They're running this strategy very well. And it's interesting. I know No Diggity's probably watching this, but if I were them, like, this style is what I think you play against No Diggity as well. You pressure them very early and aggressively, control the lanes, force them to be reactive, and just punish their greed. And that's really what PR has done in both of these games. And even in the previous series when they beat DB a week or so ago, it's the same style. DB just not the most experienced team. And I feel like this Chen specifically is really throwing them off balance. I mean, hit. 5 assists, level 8, you know? Like, he's more leveled. He's equal to the mid player, or at least he just was a second ago.
It's just crazy that a team like DB, like, I know you said, like, the inexperience, but some of these guys have been around for forever, like, including Dota 1. Like, the inexperience really shouldn't be there. And you're also playing on a team which has, like, one of the greatest junglers back from Dota 1 days, Ryze. Like, all it's got to do is, like, teach Noya the movements that an Enchantress or a Chen would make, or how to actually stop it, because he should know all about it himself.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Again, that kind of, I don't know, it's just, it's mostly, I think, a lack of playing at a really high level. I think part of the reason you'll see EG in secret, like, always doing well, even though they consistently shuffle their roster, is just because the amount of experience and the high Dota IQ that every player possesses, where a lot of these teams don't necessarily, as you say, like, know intuitively, like, how do you stop a Chen? What is a bounty hunter supposed to do?
How do you actually...
They're going for goddamn, but...
Wow, a Sunstrike, combine it with a stun. J4's got Finger of Death, say goodbye to your Nightstalker. He's draining out the mana from Penguin. He's got Windrun up in 4 seconds time. But OD, yeah, you're not going to go back into that goddamn. You were saved perfectly by your teammate and got a revenge kill.
He actually would have got a double kill, but I don't think he expected the Lion to perfectly double stun them like that. But if the OD had been a little more manly, that's a double kill. And again, they're still pushing bottom in the meantime, and you still can't fight them down here.
Well,
they might get this Chen.
Sunstrike's off cooldown as well, so if Cheshire Cat wants to buy some space, he could do so. The mech's already been expended by Big Num, and he brings his creeps right back on top of Noya. The Splinter Blast will actually be helpful then, because they mop up the entire Chen army as well as the Chen himself.
Yep.
And that was on the back of a track kill.
Four-man rotation for one kill. In the meantime, Invoker's going to get this mid-tower for free, and they're not going to get an objective bottom, so they're just being forced to play reactively.
Noya's coming in for the denial. You still got four spirits in the front lines, but he'll get the denial anyway. As OD, okay, well, goodbye Gyrocopter in the tree line. That wasn't even an eclipse to get the kill, that was Chronosphere control.
Yep. Void ulti into OD damage and a Sunstrike, and that's a kill. And that'll happen for the entire game. And again, the Gyrocopter dies. If you check out the net worth, man, DB's just in a really tough spot. Like, they're nearly 10,000 gold behind already. And it doesn't really feel like the game is that out of hand, but
J4?
This is what happens when you're forced to chase the other team around for this long.
Oh, he's got 1 HP! He's gonna get the stun! He's got- Oh, he blinks! Into the trees and TP out! He was on 1 HP! The last tick from the urn dropped him down to 1 H bloody P! And his TP away is successful. DB cannot catch a break. Oh...
Man.
And now Goddamn's gonna get revealed. You don't have Chronosphere available, he's gonna trigger the drums. There goes your curse. Cheshire Cat.
Nope.
Just, yeah, there's too much support. Arise is already here, too.
Yep. Yeah, this is the problem, again, with their team. Like, just such low damage output. The Wyvern ulti, like, as weird as it sounds, it can't be used like that for them to get a foothold in this game. It has to be offensively utilized. It needs to result in the death of a core, because Invoker auto-attacks it to death with a cooldown then on top. But the AoE is just not there.
J4.
No lines initiating on
jumping
top.
Jumping up bottom lane with a stun. The Sunstrike again going to be on top of Aces. No straight follow-up. In comes that time dilation from Cheshire Cat, but with no Chronosphere, they don't have the ulti combo just yet, but OD starts to steal a little bit of intelligence. Looking for more of it. There's 10 of it. But he's holding on
no
to the Eclipse for now. They're not going to go yet.
But again, like, they lose the support, but they're playing this smart. I think PR recognizes the situation they're in. Don't chase for the kills. Take it slow. Let's see if they want to fight us for this objective. And the answer is probably not. They might smoke here, but no Wyvern ulti. I just don't think it's possible.
No Wyvern ulti, and Nightstalker also burnt his darkness. That was the only reason why we were in nighttime just then. Like, it's now 9 a.m. on the Dota clock. So with the darkness burnt, all you lost was the Lion, and now he'll come into the mid. Fortification mid, that's not available. J4, however, will get the Hex. Hesijo and Ryza right behind him, so they're not going to go for it. But there's a blink dagger over on the face of Void. You got easy Chronos coming your way. And PR now actually going to force them to come into a fight. They're going to go for Roshan, yep. And it's up to DB if they want to try and contest.
If you look at wards, they have the vision advantage really hard right now in PR. They have way more minions, more disable, and obviously at this point more gold, but specifically the initiation potential. A blink Void and a blink Lion. A lot of times Void could just blink in with a W and that'll be enough to just turn the other team around and make them run. Daytime as well, so there's really no way for DB to contest this.
Yep, they'll let it go. But now you got Negus Immortal giving confidence to an OD. I always kind of feel a little odd when when OD gets it, because he doesn't keep his intel after the Aegis Immortal burns.
Yep. Invis rune on the Void. They're going to find this Ancient Stack and maybe a kill on the Windranger too. He's going to run right into him. He'll block him there. All right, yeah, see if they noticed.
Nope, he didn't ping at all. He might have been shopping.
Oh, this is the dream.
He wasn't shopping.
Oh no, he's going to get him right as he goes to the Ancients maybe. Maybe they'll rotate top. We'll see.
Is there any
sentries or anything? This is going to be at least one kill.
Oh, he's got two of them.
Nope.
He's got two of them now. Alright, he's just going to settle for Ace. The curse is available, but it's already too late. That Gyrocopter is dead.
That's the problem with Wyvern in this game.
Like, well,
Cheshire
you're
Cat. Pretty much picking him.
You're going to trigger Darkness from Hester Joe. They're going over on that Faceless Void. And the Shackle launches perfectly, but Cheshire can't, because the Sun from J4, he'll be out of time lapse up all the damage. And then J4, they just turn the damage into the Windranger. Hester Joe also being call stunned up. He cannot escape. We're 3 for 13 at the moment. But PR is looking pretty damn good. Like, I'll be surprised if they even lose another hero in this game. They're just hitting everything.
3 minutes more until the total game time hits about 40 minutes. I mean, I kind of saw this coming a little bit, but I thought that DB would kind of read the situation, but they're straight up just losing to the same strategy, some of the same heroes, and just the same core game plan, and they just aren't prepared here.
Bring in more Auras. The Vlad's now on the Faceless Void too.
Yep. If you look at the net worth, like, it's just Wyvern, Nightstalker, Bounty. These heroes just don't do enough. And Windranger did not is 0-3-0. So just not having the impact you need for them to win this game.
God, they won't have any more impact anyway. Goddamn, just completed up a full BKB. Like, we're not even 20 minutes in on this OD. And he's gonna have his BKB. They have Mech Hand of God. Invoker. What's actually your choice here, Arise? Because he could build up BTs right now, but I don't know if Split Push is really what he requires. He could almost go directly into an Aghanim Scepter. Like, he's already got the Eel Scepter to speak with, to go for. To play with. Words, phrasing. Put words together to make a wonderful sentence. Is it even worth
BKB
him? Just worth him going for a BKB for the Invoker and join the OD with his own BKB?
No, I think Ags is fine. Because the Invoker is already going to be playing, like, off to the side. His only main job is to make sure he's not just, like, surrounded by a Chen army and potentially in a position to where the OD gets Wyvern ulted and dies. Because when you're BKB'd, the Wyvern ult won't affect you, but it can still be used on you. So what DB needs to win this fight is a Wyvern ulti on the OD that kills him to set up their engagement.
Ace.
So all Arise
Chronosphere.
Do that doesn't
they really want this Gyrocopter. With the stun and the Sunstrike, Faceless Void's last attack will get the kill. And they find an imprisonment 2 over on the Windranger. She was wind running away. Down comes the Meteorite, the Penguin. He's actually not burning at this point, but goddamn. Well, he's got all the damage in the world. 25 intel stolen as well. DB come into this, that Eclipse will just burst them. So they are not going to fight it, but they got no choice. PR now can go high ground. They still have that Aegis the Immortal for another 1.5 minutes.
This is all they gotta do. Just throw out a Chrono, get secure a kill, chase for more. Make sure that if you're gonna fight, it's gonna be as 5. And they're doing that every time. Like, there's just not enough damage output. What does Bounty Nightstalker do right now? Like, they're gonna throw out Tracks and Wyvern Ws, but they have so much sustain that it's just not gonna be enough. And that might be a dead Nightstalker. You can see the pinks coming out.
Yeah, Sunstrike. Oh, missed the timing on it though. The Finger of Death and the Orb attacks will still be enough. So yeah, Nightstalker will die, Ace back to World of Living, and PR, they will back out. And we already have another item onto Goddamn. After he just completed the BKB before this push, he now has a Blink Dagger as well.
Yep. I think this game is like 80% draft. PR is definitely playing well, but I just... it's just a hard game for DB because you think about Bounty Hunter, and yes, it's traditionally something you use to counter junglers, but if you don't effectively roam, then the Chen, like, look at a Chen level 10 against the Bounty level 8. You know, yes, he's throwing out tracks and shit, but Chen's got a mech, his ulti, and four creeps, you know? And Bounty just doesn't do anything to that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. The Invoker's going to have Ag soon, and then their timing is just so strong. And as you said, the Blink on OD, so he can just blink in with Reckless Abandon. They have nothing to deal with him once he's BKB'd, with the exception of that Wyvern ulti. And as we talked about, they don't need it. It can't just be used for control in this game. They need to actually kill the OD with it when they offensively Wyvern ult him. And
oh,
I just don't see PR making them think.
Something for them. The Hex, J4, he's still got 8-1 charges available. Hasn't triggered them yet. Now he does. The Sunstrike's on Ace. J4. The Hand of God's good, but okay, Hester Joe just runs all the way in. He needed something. The Chronosphere is going to be coming out right now from Cheshire Cat, holding him there. Goddamn can buy a little bit more time with his own imprisonment. But Hester Joe, okay, there's a blink over. Imprisoned him to actually find two kills. The Oldie Ulti almost killed the Bounty Hunter as well. Actually, wow. It will kill him as he comes out of the level 4 Astral Imprisonment. That worked nicely. Everyone else just bails out, quick TPs and leave.
Yeah. I think it's just, again, it's just all the draft, really.
Arise? There's Sunstrike? Oh. Meteorite? Trap 1, Centaur Stomp number 2. That bottom tower's almost down as well. The Chen army's gonna be lost, he can't pull it back in time. The only thing he manages to hold on to is the range creep that he converted.
Yep.
I mean, the radiant creep, not range creep.
Ryze is so farmed, man. So is this OD.
Yeah.
I do want to say, though, like, PR as a whole, I don't really see a consistent strength or weakness to their team right now. I think they're just playing really solid team Dota, but their support play has been really, really nice from Bignum and J4 in both of the games they're going to win.
So what was the difference between game 1 and game 3 then? Like, what has changed so much in this team?
It's really just the draft, I think, man. It's the difference between having a Chen and having a hero that requires you to make things happen. And again, I believe the first game they were playing against the Ench. So maybe it's just junglers, man. I mean, Secret was 10-0 with them at the Shanghai Major. And it just seems to me like it's much easier to execute strategies when you have a hero that can either out-farm the enemy support or be far more valuable in a dual try or ganking situation. So, I mean, there's a reason that you play Alliance, you ban, like, Ench Chen and not Bulldog heroes, so I'd say that that's the keys to success, at least in this series.
Ryze is going to break the smoke, he saw the DB players moving out of here. TPs are coming back, Faceless Void leaps up, he gets a two-man chrono, both ping as well as ace, isolating Hester Joe on the low ground, but Ryze knows where the bigger targets are. Hester Joe can be dealt with by just J4 and the Forge Spirits. And that is, that is a brutal envelopment of DB.
And mid lane's exposed, so that'll be a Rax without buybacks.
You got three of them. So they will have to use them.
0-5-0 on the Windranger. 1-7 on the Nightstalker. 2-6 on the Gyro. All the cores not having the greatest game. And it's a lot just on the draft, man. You pick a really low damage offlaner, two supports, low damage, and then a Windranger, which is really hit or miss. Literally, do you win the lane, do you hit the shackles, and how farm do you get? But, I mean, this is going to be at least one Rax, and this is tough for DB here.
You notice the saddest situation when your only counter push is track to Shuriken Toss. That's your highest amount of damage you have that pushes PR to any point of thought that, oh, maybe we should actually back out. DB almost have to go for an all or nothing soon. There's still an Observer and Sentry sitting inside their base. They can't even smoke where they are and go. Actually, do they even have one? Because they burn a lot of smokes. They have... Okay, they got one in stock. They got one smoke in stock. But that kind of feels like that's going to be all she wrote. If that doesn't work, then nothing will. Like, this OD is getting closer and closer to a Scythe. He may even solo attempt this kill. With four spirits arising, Ace losing armor very quickly. And, well, Eclipse, he's just going to imprison him. I don't know if that's enough damage, but with the Sunstrike, okay, that's enough damage. Wow. And Ryze just threw out a Splinter Blast, revealing himself so J4 can jump him. I think DB is finally tilting over the edge. That wasn't even necessary, J4.
Yeah, this... It's just such a tough position, man. It's so grim to be where DB is. I respect him for not giving up, but you just kind of have to know that the noose is tightening and the stool is gone and your life starts to flash before your eyes and Russia slips away. But it's just, what do you do here? I'd love to theorycraft an idea, but I got nothing, man.
There really isn't a lot. Like, your only hope is the fact that DB, and this is the most optimistic thinking ever. Okay, Wind Ranger Sunstrike, hello? Invoker? Nope. Arise just arise himself. Penguin's gonna go down. Hesajo now realizes he's also bitten off a lot more than he can chew. And he actually gets time locked as well. Just to add insult to injury, that blink dagger from Arise is up. He's trying to get the ice wall and turns it into a body block. They got time dilation once again, and they're actually calling it. They understand this game is over. You can juke all you want to. Hesajo will not survive because the Sunstrike's going to kill him. But the game is over, and Power Rangers will get a chance at revenge up against No Diggity in the best of five grand final tomorrow night.
Just a comment. Arise in game one, he was 3-7-7. The two games he just played as Invoker, he was a combined 12-0-15. So I would say that it's a team victory, but I think that Arise's performance is a pretty good standard for which way the game is going for PR. So glad to see him perform like that. And I mean, No Diggity PR was, what, like 5 hours? I'm so thrilled I get to cast that for five games instead of three this time.
It looks like we actually start earlier as well. Originally, I thought that game time was actually going to be 18 CEST, but it's actually now 16 CEST start time.
Wait, 16?
Yeah.
Tomorrow?
Yeah.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
Oh, come on, Toby.
I know. I didn't know myself until I just double-checked the start times. But we have a 16 CEST start, No Diggity versus now Power Rangers Grand Final Best of Five.
Okay.
I'm sorry, bro.
It's all right. I'm actually, I know I was getting some complaints about the mic. I'm going to actually switch to an Audio-Technica tomorrow, so I should have, like, flawless quality. I just didn't have time to do it today. Wasn't expecting to cast, but Toby, Toby couldn't find a caster.
I'm sorry. I'm so alone, all right? I have no friends.
Tweet at him, guys. Toby, yeah, exactly. Toby needs friends, guys. Yeah. Tweet at him. Hashtag, I'll be your friend or something.
Yeah.
And give the guy some love. He works hard.
He'll hardly working sometimes. Either way. I look forward to seeing everyone back tomorrow. Swindles will be with me, as he said, for the grand final. So if you're actually enjoying our casting combination, please let us know. Nothing like words of encouragement to keep it going. As Power Rangers.
Toby?
Sorry?
Can I just do some shameless self-promotion?
I think you've deserved the right for some shameless self-promotion.
Nice. Okay, well, I'm actually starting a new program. It's called Kappa Free. Every viewer, if you're in chat for an hour and you don't use a Kappa, you get 10 cents, okay? And that's redeemable at the Swindle store, coming soon to new Nike locations near you.
Are you actually bullshitting?
Nah, I'm completely full of shit, but I'm just saying you should tune in and watch the stream. It's not Flash Melons. Flash Melons with two Z's. It's like really, really attractive, talented Dota players all over my house. You can get a glimpse of them. And yeah, I guess, I don't know. Like I said, man, I need to get more following so that I can start selling my dignity. That's the dream, isn't it?
That is not the dream, man. Hold on to your dignity. It's the only thing that keeps you in this industry.
But man, you get a good price for it. I don't know.
It's never worth it. Hold on to your dignity. All right, guys, we're wrapping this up. Enjoy your night. ESL coverage is still going on. Durker is casting that one at the moment, but we're back for the ESL China. I think I should know. SEA qualifiers are going on tomorrow. Fnatic versus XCTN, Trust versus MVP, which we're providing coverage for. And actually, at the end of that, more than likely, that's exactly when Epicenter will begin. So that's when you can tune in for Diggity versus Power Rangers. Now we have more Dota 2 action coming up during the night. As in fact, it is going to be DB playing up against Empire tomorrow night in the European qualifier. That one's a little bit later in the evening at 20 CEST. So no matter what happens, again, as we always seem to be doing. doing right now, almost every single day. Actually, it is every single day for the last month. We've had Dota 2 coming out from a Join Dota live stream. So keep following all the streams, follow the website as well. We have countdowns to the streams up in the top right corner, so very easy to find. And we'll see you either at the LAN event or tomorrow night at 16 CEST for our European Grand Final.